Beware the prophet. Beware the children who follow him.
What happened to you in the first 100?
I was lucky. He had grown up and cared about me.
Welcome to the Museum of Civilization.
What's it like to live through a pandemic that kills millions of people around the world? Well, we're living it, but not like this. Station 11 depicts a world of a sudden and devastating pandemic that nearly wipes out the planet. It's a dystopia unlike any other. At the center of the series, a nomadic troupe of Shakespearean actors who entertain the survivors. It is joyful, haunting, and at times deeply disturbing. It's also a look at human beings and how we connect to one another, how we form community, and how we tell the stories that link us all together. Station 11 is a limited series based on the novel by the same title from Emily St. John Mandel. The TV series is streaming now on HBO Max, and its creator and showrunner is Patrick Somerville. Patrick joins us now on Frank Buckley Interviews. Patrick, welcome, and thank you for hours of deeply entertaining TV.
Well, thanks for having me, and you're welcome. I'm glad you liked it.
I really did. Let's talk about how this came to the screen. The book came out in 2014. You'd agreed to do this long before the COVID-19 pandemic came along, but then you start shooting in early 2020, just as the virus does start to infect people. Do I have it right?
You have it right. We developed the show all through 2019, and I would say it's a show made by a large group of people who never would have gone on to make a show about a pandemic if we knew there was a pandemic going on. So we were kind of in a strange situation where we were committed. We prepped all through fall 2019 and shot in January and February, and we were getting inklings, like the rest of the country in those months, that something was happening. But as we all remember, it wasn't exactly clear to everyone in January and February what was coming. And we had a planned shutdown anyways in or mid-February, and so we had to wait for the summertime. And in our planned shutdown, the world shut down. And we waited, like everyone else, to find out what was going to happen. And we didn't get back into production for almost a year.
So to be clear, yeah, you're a show about a pandemic that is shut down because of a real pandemic. Let me back up for a second. You said that if you had known that there was going to be a pandemic, you wouldn't have done the series. Why?
I think that we, as the makers of the show, were drawn to the idea of the story, not for anything sensationalistic, but because of kind of the opportunity, the idea of the flu in Emily's novel presented to examine just sort of technology and life before, and then what was possible in life after. We were drawn to it for reasons always that had little to do with kind of the horror of something like this happening. And so I'm glad we were doing it, and I'm glad that we did it. But I think that we just were a unique group in terms of what we were interested in. We weren't interested in the scariest feelings that come with something like this. And a lot of times, I think in a Hollywood production, what you go after when there's a large scale disaster is exactly kind of the scary conflict and things that we all live through. And I would just say, you know, having lived through it now, we're all exhausted. Like, yeah. we don't need stories about exactly, you know, the worst times, but I do think what we need stories about are how to rebuild, how to heal, how to reckon with what's happened and still kind of get up out of bed every day and keep going forward.
Well, the one thing that I will say about your series, there's such a great humanity in it. And that's what, to me, came through, was the humanity of these people going through this moment. And I wondered, as I was watching it, because you were making it during a pandemic, this is a sort of a trite word, but did that make it more special amongst the people who were making it. Does that make sense?
It does, and it did. And I think everyone remembers what it was like March, April, May, when the pandemic was first starting, and the feeling of being trapped in your home, but also the feeling of loss about all the little things that we do to make ourselves kind of feel okay. Going out to dinner, going and seeing friends, going into public spaces, going to see a show, and going to the movies. And we lost all that. And a funny thing about making the TV show, I mean, I had to leave my family behind here in LA when I went to set, and I was gone for almost 5 months. That was a tremendous loss. But while there, inside the company, we got to see live music. That was Navon Rizwan rapping and Matilda Lawler singing The First Noel and Deborah Cox singing Midnight Train to Georgia. But we were standing on set, but we got to kind of share something as a group together that was a little, it was pretty special to be able to be in this little pocket, protected and safe, making our show, but also kind of all getting to be together at work. I don't think a lot of people got to kind of, I don't know, get inside of a bubble and keep doing what they love in the old way, standing right next to people. Something about hearing live music too, man. Yeah. When you don't for a year, and then you hear Deborah Cox belting out Midnight Train to Georgia, it gives you chills.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, it's funny, to your point earlier about not wanting to do a show about a pandemic during a pandemic, I think most of us, or many of us, discovered how much good stuff is on streaming services during this pandemic that maybe we weren't watching. And everyone was asking everyone else, hey, what's good? What are you watching? And your series was one of those that I've consistently said to people, you've got to see Station 11. Then they'd say, well, what's it about? And I would say, well, it's about a pandemic.
Bear with me.
Right. And most people would say, well, I don't know if I really want to watch a show about a pandemic. Did you encounter that as you were trying to get people interested in it? And was it awkward for HBO Max to try to promote it against the backdrop of a pandemic?
Well, HBO Max never blinked about putting the show out, which I think in and of itself says a ton about their commitment to it. But they knew what it was beyond what I would say the most difficult episode to watch for people is the first episode, because I think it hits pretty close to home. But it's not a show about pain. It's not a show about awful things happening. It doesn't get its drama from people suffering. It gets its drama from people getting better, from joy. The pitch always, long before COVID, when I was going around trying to sell it to networks, was a post-apocalyptic show about joy. Because I don't think anyone had tried that. You know, I don't think anyone had flipped that genre on its head and said, okay, there's a disaster, but what if you don't keep watching the more disasters that happen? What if you skip further and show a stable time of life when people have found kind of a sure footing and are still reckoning with all the loss and not pretending that didn't happen, but living, you know, continuing on after a hard thing happened. And I think there's something very hopeful in that for us, it turned out too, because we're kind of stuck in it now. Still, I think a lot of people are really tired, but I think there's a glimmer of, okay, you know, hold the line, keep going.
Right.
There's going to be a different reality around the corner. You can't tell when, but there is.
And trust me, at least within the context of the series, there are beautiful payoffs if you stick with it, and it's just terrific. One thing in terms of the backstory of getting this to TV was the fact that Emily St. John, Mandel, who wrote the book, you met her many years ago, and as I understand it, both of you were sort of at a crossroads in your writing careers. Tell me about that, and then how you then come full circle to end up actualizing her written word into TV.
That's right. We were both mid-list authors, young, early 30s novelists who had some success, but it's confusing when you you're writing books, they're getting published, they're getting reviewed, and yet it's hard to make a living in literary fiction. And she and I read at a small bookstore outside of Chicago. And the reason we were connected was because we had a mutual friend. And the nightmare when you're going around on reading tours and you don't have a huge fan base is, what if I go and no one shows up? So what you do is you kind of bond together with one other writer and hope that you'll collectively kind of get enough people in the door. We went, four people came for me and Emily. It was maybe not the most successful reading, but what was great was the time we spent together. I picked her up from O'Hare and we drove and talked, and I said, you know, this is, I don't know if I can support a family doing this. I kind of want to get into TV. And she said, I'm gonna try writing one more novel and see how that goes. And 2 years later, I was sitting in the writer's room of The Bridge, the first show I ever worked on FX, and I see on the New York Times Station 11 by Emily St. John Mandel on the bestseller list. And I was happy for her, but then when I read it, I just loved it too. So I always had my eye on it after that, because I thought it would make a great show. It took another 6 years to figure it out, but we reconnected, and the rest is history.
Just amazing. What an amazing backstory that led to a wonderful story that we can enjoy both in book form and in TV form. We're going to take a short break. When we get back, more with Patrick Somerville, the creator and showrunner of the HBO Max limited series, Station 11.
When are you going to take me home? My parents don't know where I am.
Well, Kirsten, I know this is all a little scary, okay? But they're saying that there's a health scare coming, okay? And people are supposed to get inside. The problem is we can't reach anyone who knows you even exist.
That's not fair.
If you want to go back to your house, you want to try and get in, we'll call a cab. We'll figure it out. Or you can spend the night at my brother's apartment. I'm not allowed to say you have to, because that's kidnapping, I think.
That's a clip from the HBO Max limited series, Station 11. We're back with the creator, showrunner, and writer, Patrick Somerville. Patrick, those two characters, who are they? And tell our viewers and our listeners how you weaved them from that moment, which is really the first night of the pandemic, all the way through the series, and which, by the way, covers various time periods. So you had a lot to do there.
Yeah. Well, that's Kirsten and Jeevan, and they just met on the night the world's ending. Jeevan knows. Kirsten doesn't really know. They're strangers. He's just trying to walk her home, but he can't find her parents. And so he's faced with a choice as an adult about, what do you do when the world's ending and you're with a little kid that you don't know? You leave him behind, or do you bring him along? Because it's our moral duty kind of to take care. And that's what kicks our series off, that relationship. There's something special about those two. I think you can feel it in that scene, which I love. I'm going to say it loud and a lot. Himesh Patel should win an Emmy for his role in Station 11.
Yes.
I hope that his work is recognized for the many places he goes and the incredible performance that he gives in the show. And the other actor there is Matilda Lawler, a gem, an incredible find. And as everyone in this town knows, you're rolling the dice when you're hanging your series on a kid. And that kid better be able to act. We found one who is real talented, and she's going to go on to have a very special career, Matilda Lawler.
You just had amazing actors all throughout this process. And talk to me about the writing process, though. You have this incredibly rich source material in the novel, and you have to strip it down, pick the elements to keep, and then write this complex series, maybe change the juxtaposition of characters or times in a way that might if you're the novelist, say, hey, wait a minute, I wrote a perfect story here. What are you doing? You happen to know Emily St. John Mandel. Do you have to say to her as a fellow novelist as well, listen, I'm doing these things. It's for TV. Trust me. How does that work?
Well, Emily's great. I mean, she's the type to always say, kind of, I have no idea how to make TV. You go do your thing, Patrick. But at the same time, too, she did write a perfect story as a novel. And when you're adapting, you got to make some changes just because of the different mediums. And so for visual storytelling, I think we needed to find a way for Jeevan to externalize some of the things he was worried about and have a partner to talk to about them throughout that first episode. And so we put Kirsten and Jeevan more together in our show than they are in the book. And I think that led to a bunch of just sort of amazing opportunities deeper in the story about that relationship. It really became kind of the emotional bedrock of the whole show.
And the prophet, who a major character in both the novel and in the show in different sort of ways, how did you approach that? And what, who is the prophet in terms of our lives in general, not in the context of the story, but who is the prophet?
The prophet's just another kid who got left behind, you know, who got failed by adults. And I don't think we need a pandemic or a disaster to understand that that happens every day in our country, in our world, in our town. Kids need help, and they need adults making good decisions around them. And sometimes you're a lucky kid and you have that, and sometimes you're not, and you don't, and you do your best. And I think his story is a lot like young Kirsten's, who you just saw there in the clip, except for the fact that he ended up alone for a long time dealing with disaster, and literally alone in the woods. The thing that Kirsten and Tyler share in common is they both had this very special graphic novel called Station 11. Only a couple copies were made. And it's what both of them held on to through the awful times to kind of keep their sanity intact and to not feel absolutely alone. And I think that's kind of what we do with art. Everyone, every kid growing up kind of has a couple things that they hold on to, and they say, okay, no matter what's going on around me, like, I got this. I got this book. I got this movie. I got this story. This makes sense. And you hold on tight until things change.
Well, let me ask you about that. As you were growing up, what was that one story?
Man, I mean, the first movie I ever saw, and the first movie I ever saw in the theater, was Return of the Jedi.
Ah.
And I was 3 and a half. I didn't have any idea what was going on, but all I knew is when I saw that Ewok steal a speeder bike and then grab a vine and scream his Ewok scream, that was my home. Well, that's what I wanted to do. I didn't know what that was or how to do it or how to make it or see more of it, but I became a kid obsessed with telling stories that made people feel that way.
Oh, that's
terrific.
That sense
of adventure.
Yeah. That is wonderful. Well, you succeeded. We're going to take one more short break. When we come back, more with Patrick Somerville, the writer, creator, showrunner of the HBO limited series, Station 11. And welcome back to Frank Buckley Interviews. We're continuing our conversation with Patrick Somerville, the creator of the HBO limited series, Station 11. Patrick, you've said this show is about joy. There is joy for sure, but what do you mean by that?
I just mean that storytelling is a funny thing because it's easy to get your drama out of awful things happening. I think it's a much harder needle to thread to tell a story that has a really earned, satisfying, emotional, positive feeling at the end of it. And earned is the key word to me there, you know, because you can make a blue skied, happy place where everybody's happy, but that doesn't ring true, you know? You have to show the audience that you understand how bad it can get too, if that's gonna be an earned joy. at the end. And so that was always the idea of this project. You know, I'm not hyper focused on that, on all things, but I do love a good hug.
and let me ask you, as a guy growing up in Wisconsin, you're now, you know, one of the top guys in Hollywood. Did you ever see this happening? Was it something you always saw happening? Tell me about that, your personal journey to get here.
You know, it's funny. I wanted to be a director. I went down to the Brown County Library and got a biography of George Lucas when I was about 9 years old. And I just obsessively read that, and I read about Steven Spielberg, and I wanted to be a movie director, but I didn't know anyone. I didn't have equipment. I decided being a writer made more sense for me because I could do it by myself with just a pencil and a notebook, basically. And so I went down that road, and that was sort of the journey I was on until my mid-30s. But the itch was always there. I love TV. I love film. And around that time I was meeting Emily, I was also thinking, you know what? I want to try to get into television and film and figure out how to do that. And I got lucky, found some people to help get inside the system finally and meet some agents and get a job. Once I was in, I was hooked because there's nothing like making a thing with a bunch of people.
Right. Well, congratulations. As I said, it's one of my favorite things of the last couple of years, and I appreciate all the work that you and your team put into it. Thank you, Patrick.
You bet, man. Thanks, Frank.
Of course. Patrick Somerville, creator, showrunner of Station 11. All 10 episodes streaming right now on HBO Max. My thanks to you for watching. I hope you'll join us on the audio podcast later this week, where we'll continue the conversation.